But I'm going to start out with a riddle. And the riddle is this: why is climate change like a Christmas tree? And to give you an answer to this riddle, I have to go back to the mid-1980s when I was a junior researcher at the US National Laboratories, Oak Ridge National Lab in the US, where I first started to take a professional interest in climate change. And this was a time, you remember, when there was very, very little public awareness of the issue. Few people had heard of the greenhouse effect. Strange as it may seem, there was such a time. And the US Congress had recently set up the National Climate Program to explore the science of climate and potential climate change, one component of which was the Carbon Dioxide Information and Analysis Center at Oak Ridge, where I was working. However, the National Climate Program's agenda was entirely confined to atmospheric science and the carbon cycle. There was no social science or economics involved. So I proposed to the director of the Oak Ridge National Lab that we could establish a modest effort to understand some of the social and policy implications of climate change alongside the science effort. Of course, he did what any sensible lab director would do. He sought opinions from his advisory board on the wisdom of investing in such an effort. And as a result of this, one of the greybeards on that science advisory board approached me in the corridor saying, "I hear you're interested in climate change as a potential policy issue." This gentleman, by the way, was a former deputy administrator of the US Environmental Protection Agency. "So that's right," I replied. He shook his head sagely and told me, "You're wasting your time, son. Climate change will never be a major public policy issue." So after a moment, I responded. I said, "Milt, why do you think that?" He says, "Well, it's easy." He says, "Three reasons. First, it's too far off in the future. Secondly, the science is too uncertain. And thirdly, there's no simple, easy villain to blame." And I thought for a moment and said, "You know, Milt, you're absolutely right. Those are the three reasons why climate change is going to be a major public policy issue. Because it's like a Christmas tree. People will bring a variety of ornaments to hang on it. They'll bring a variety of issues to hang on to climate change, just as they would hang ornaments on a tree. And so indeed, to switch metaphors a bit, climate change became something of a bandwagon. And we've seen agenda after agenda being piled on top of it. Energy agendas, environmental, developmental, humanitarian, political, technological, economic, ethical, cultural, even religious concerns. In fact, throughout the first decade of this century, the 21st, it's almost impossible to discuss any energy or environmental issue except in terms of its impact on carbon emissions. For example, I was serving at that time on the Royal Commission on Environmental Pollution. We produced a report on light pollution, and we were under tremendous pressure to frame this in terms of carbon savings. We said, "No, actually, we just want people to turn the lights out at night so that ordinary folks can enjoy the beauty of the heavens." So climate change debates are not about climate, certainly not all about climate. In some cases, they're not about climate at all. And of course, in that respect, they're not unique. For example, the UK's GM nation debate in 2002 to 2003 was very narrowly framed by the government. Discussion of the issue of public acceptability of GM foods was restricted to essentially the issues of human health, adverse environmental impacts, and economics. And there was no room for anything else, despite the fact that what the public really wanted to talk about was its concerns about food in the countryside, the future of the countryside. In the US, where there was no visible expert controversy about health and impacts at this time, such concerns among Europeans were regarded as rather strange and quaint. And I was actually asked to explain the European concerns to readers of Newsweek, where I argued that it seemed to me that the concerns were not so much the cause of public disquiet as the limited opportunity space available to publics to assert their standing in the debate, to discuss things that were being kept out of the debate. And whereas North Americans, for the most part, if you say the word nature, generally speaking, think about wild nature, the national parks, the wilderness areas where no human hand has set foot, Europeans tend to talk about the countryside or the Kulturlandschaft or the terroir. Whereas Americans live apart from nature, Europeans live within nature. So the kinds of concerns you'd have about the industrialization of agriculture would be very different in a European context, whereas not being addressed within the frameworks of expertise that were admitted to the official discourse. In other words, divergent worldviews are not likely to be reconciled by expert arbitration of technical matters. And here, this is a well-established framework offered by my colleague Jerry Revetz and his partner Sylvia Funtowitz, where you can see that worldviews dominate the discussion, where either the decision stakes or the system's uncertainty in a problem is high. And worldviews become pretty much unassailable where both of those conditions prevail at the top right, furthest from the origin on the diagram, where the ability of experts to arbitrate increases only as issues move from that area back down towards the origin. Now, in principle, this lovely cartoon should enable us to decide when technical expertise can legitimately and effectively be used and when society needs to resort to different kinds of discourse, engaging wider constituencies in order to make effective and sensible policy decisions. Unfortunately, of course, things aren't quite so simple, because people with different worldviews will themselves place the same issue in a very different place on this diagram. Cultural theory, anthropological theory, suggests, for example, that hierarchical organizational cultures, such as those we often associate with government bureaucracies, tend to rely on rules and procedures in decision-making. Hence, they'll tend to drive as many issues as possible down towards the origin on this diagram, for the obvious reason that that's the mode of decision-making with which they feel the most comfortable. On the other hand, we find that egalitarian cultures, including groups such as radical environmentalists, patient activists, etc., will try to frame as many problems as they can as being wicked, pushing up to the top of the diagram in order to have a broad social discourse about the ethics and the good vision of the good society that is represented by the within the controversy in question. And while we also find a third kind of cultural setting, that of the entrepreneurial culture, the competitive individualist, who is happiest in the complex world between these two extremes, because this is the realm of expert judgment, and that's exactly what these folks see themselves as excelling at. Now, this cultural picture is made a bit more complicated because each of the decision-making cultures also seems to manifest a very characteristic view of nature. These little icons originated in the work of the Canadian ecologist Buzz Holling, where he used them to describe different views of nature that he saw as underlying competing forest management strategies designed to combat spruce budworm infestations in British Columbia. We anthropologists have borrowed these three simple icons to describe these different views of nature. So the first is that of nature ephemeral. The image here is of a ball balanced on an upturned bowl. Any perturbation is likely to displace the ball, resulting in an irreversible change of state. This we find is a commonplace view among the egalitarian cultures, where phrases such as nature's delicate balance are commonplace. And in complete contrast, we find the image of nature benign. Here is where the ball is in the cup which has been turned the right way around, and it can be vigorously perturbed with confidence that it's going to return to an equilibrium state. And advocates of this view often point, for example, to the very rapid recovery of Prince William Sound from the Exxon Valdez oil spill. This view seems to be very much associated with competitive individualistic cultures. Hierarchical cultures have their own particular take on nature, that one that Holling described as perverse tolerant. The ball lies in a hollow, in a landscape, perhaps a saucer, and this permits a certain amount of perturbation, but not too much. Or else the ball will go rolling off who knows where. Now, the unique problem facing this hierarchical culture is to know just how deep is that depression in the landscape, and exactly where is the ball in relationship to the bottom or the top of the slope. And that's why hierarchical decisions are always at the mercy, decision makers are always at the mercy of technical experts to monitor and to analyze the situation. And then they have the problem, to which kind of expert should they listen? To the procedural expert of consensual science, close to the origin on the Funtowitz and Rabbits diagram, or to the more contentious expertise of the competitive individualist? By the way, did you notice what happened there? Something interesting happened. We go from nature to the economy, we find there's a fascinating switch. The competitive culture worries about the fragility of the economy. It knows that nature's forgiving, but it worries about the fragility of the economy. While the egalitarian is convinced that the economy is actually much more resilient than the environment. So contrast, for instance, George W. Bush, who very famously said, the American way of life is not up for grabs. We're not going to risk the American economy by implementing expensive climate change measures. And you compare that with Al Gore, who set up an investment company with his partner David Blood, Generation Investments. Why they didn't call it Blood and Gore, I don't know. It would be a much better name. Generation Investments, and basically arguing that, yes, you might get some short-term disruption, but green policies will not only return economies to equilibrium, but actually to a higher equilibrium than that which they set out from. So we've got, I think, sufficient reason here to question how effective can expert judgment and expert declarations be in resolving disputes where systems uncertainty and decision stakes are high, as in the case of climate change. And the assumption of efficacious expertise has certainly been front and center in climate change policy discourse. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was established precisely to create a global consensus about climate change science, to remedy that deep uncertainty about climate science that led my interlocutor at Oak Ridge all those years ago to declare that climate change would indeed never be a major public policy issue. The quarter century since the establishment of the IPCC has seen spectacular growth in the disciplines of atmospheric physics and chemistry, which were previously really quite small and marginal. Climatology and oceanography also, related sciences, as well as we've seen a proliferation of climate change modeling and integrated assessment modeling. However, as these technical fields have experienced exponential growth, we've also seen increasing skepticism and criticism of climate science as a reliable guide to policy. And as we have already seen, I think, at this meeting, the criticisms cover quite a spectrum. At one end, there are relatively polite professional disagreements about the adequacy of data or the representation of particular processes in models. And these arguments are usually conducted in the pages of academic journals or in debates at professional meetings. But at their most extreme, these differences become open denunciation of climate science as a fraudulent political project to hamstring industry, impose global government, and so on. And these conversations are usually conducted on the websites of bloggers, the tabloid press, and in Fox News. And at the same time as these controversies have emerged, public concern about climate change generally, we find, has declined over the past decade. And this is partly due to the dominance of concerns about economic recovery, but it's also partly due to what I would describe as catastrophe fatigue. How many times can people be lectured that there's only X years to save the planet before they start to wonder what is all the fuss about? So whatever their origins, scientists and politicians alike have responded to climate skepticism and decline of public concern by robustly defending the science. In 2005, the UK government's then chief science advisor, Sir David King, responded to critics of climate science by insisting that, quote, the science of climate change is a mature subject. There's little room to criticise climate models. In 2007, Senator Gore declared, the science is settled. Well, that's settled it then, hasn't it? A theme that was echoed by environmentalists and climatologists worldwide. Now, exactly what is meant by the science in this context is not a fixed object. Sometimes it seems simply to be an assertion of the basic physics of carbon dioxide forcing, plus the attribution of rising carbon dioxide levels to human activity. But the 2009 ClimateGate controversy saw the scientific community circling the wagons around a much more ambitious interpretation of the skillfulness of the models and a focus on the prospect and consequences of high sensitivity. Legitimate critics of the more alarmist predictions, such as Judith Curry of Georgia Tech, were, as she put it, unceremoniously tossed out of the tribe for suggesting that climate sensitivity is likely to be at the low end of the range, as we've just heard discussed today by Professor Bates. And if you go on the web and actually look, Google on Professor Bates, you will see that he too has been subject to a campaign of ad hominem nem vituperative criticism. Anyway, given all these assertions about the maturity of the science, you would have thought there would be expert rejoicing at the recent confirmation of this by the chief executive of Australia's National Research Organisation, the CSIRO. In February this year, he issued a statement in which he said, quote, our climate models are among the best in the world, and our measurements hone those models to prove climate change. That question has been answered. Great, you'd think the scientific community would be overjoyed by this. Not so. Actually, his announcement was greeted with alarm and dismay. It's exemplified by this statement from one of Australia's leading climate scientists, who said, climate science is not solved. Most of the uncertainty in climate is due to uncertainty about the ways to represent physical processes in climate models. So what happened to that mature, settled science? Well, it seems that Marshall's ringing endorsement of the success of CSIRO's climate research was included in an announcement of significant cuts of 60 positions in the 444 strong staff of the Oceans and Atmosphere Group. So scientists acting in self-interest is not a monopoly of the manufacturers of doubt. Another example of climate scientists insisting on the incompleteness of their knowledge relates to our understanding of clouds and how to represent that understanding in models. One of the areas I work in is climate change geoengineering governance. And there I encounter scientists involved in the development of cloud brightening technology, that's this thing on the right-hand side here, as a possible geoengineering strategy to counteract climate change. And they emphasize that their experiments, such as the EPIS experiment illustrated on the left here, carried out by Scripps Institute of Oceanography in California, is absolutely essential to resolving continuing uncertainties about the behavior of clouds in what I still call quaintly general circulation models. Well, it would seem that the science has never been as mature or settled as has often been claimed. If we really don't understand the role of clouds in the GCMs, really how much reliance should we really be placing on the GCMs? There's also here an assumption of the inevitability of scientific progress, the idea that throw enough money and effort at the problem and it will in time be knowable. And that's something questionable as well when we're dealing with very complex indeterminate systems. Furthermore, it's always been my experience all along that if you get the modelers talking over a beer, they will readily share with you many of the imperfections of the models that they work with. Indeed, the most fierce defenders of the unassailable status of climate change science are not the modelers themselves. They tend to be other scientists and activist stakeholders in climate debates. This is something known as the McKenzie uncertainty trough. It was originally designed by Don McKenzie to show how confidence in the performance of intercontinental ballistic missiles varies as you move from the cold place of actually designing and producing them through the policy sphere where people are actually advocating active deployment, at least having them. And then you get to a wider public as you move further away from the coalface. And of course, what he's arguing here is that the people who produce these things really know that they can't really hit a barn door in the Ukraine with unerring accuracy. But the generals and the politicians will tell you that they can because that's what they want to believe, and the wider public becomes more skeptical still. So what you actually have here is a configured user group, very much as I would argue we have with climate change. In fact, what we have is a scientific community that has configured a user group. This diagram, known as the McKenzie uncertainty trough, also helps us to understand a phenomenon I've referred to elsewhere as the perpetuation of inappropriate expertise. And that's a way of describing the continued dominance of climate change discourse by climatologists. Once the users have been configured to rely on particular kinds of expertise in the early formulation of a problem, in this case climate, they tend to be locked into those sources of information and advice, even if the problem structure fundamentally changes over time. So to exemplify this, let's return to the announcement of personnel cuts in CSIRO's Oceans and Atmosphere Group. Having said that the question of the validity of climate change science had been answered, CSIRO's Larry Marshall went on to pose what he called the new question. And I quote, "The new question is, what do we do about it? And how can we find solutions for the climate we will be living in?" Jolly good, eh? What we do about climate change, however, is clearly not a question that climatologists can answer. But actually, the question's not so new. In 2001, I was asked to review the report of the Committee on Abrupt Climate Change of the US National Research Council. The draft that I reviewed concluded correctly, in my view, that abrupt climate change is a low probability but high consequence event. Therefore, it argued attempts to predict it and its consequences would be of questionable value. The imperative was rather to develop the societal capacity to deal with such eventualities by building social and technological resilience. Now, this would imply that the relevant skill sets would not be climatology or integrated assessment, but fields such as transportation and land use planning, agronomy, emergency management, and so on. However, the six recommendations of the report consisted of two climate modelling programmes, two lots of economic modelling, and two data collection projects to support the modelling efforts. I pointed out this anomaly in my review. The committee responded, but sadly not by changing the recommendations to bring them into line with their conclusions, but by watering down the conclusions so that the anomaly would not be so obvious. And this is what I mean by the perpetuation of inappropriate expertise. And one of its problems that it has imposed on climate change discourse is to divert attention away from the issues of how to respond to climate change to focus on the accuracy and precision of the climate science. The over-reliance on climate science as a source of authority for climate policy is clearly one factor leading to the wholly unreasonable expectation that climate science should meet an impossibly high standard of accuracy and skill. And why scientists continue to defend it so vehemently to the outside world despite their knowledge of its imperfections. Wouldn't it be better to acknowledge those imperfections, admit there are flaws in the models which require tweaking, as recommended in a recent issue of Science magazine? The point is surely that even with all its flaws, climate change science is no worse than the quality of information that governments routinely use to promote economic and social policies, even decisions to go to war, and which businesses use for mergers and acquisitions to launch new products. So how have we got into this situation where climate change is being held to this extraordinary platinum standard of accuracy and precision? It seems rather bizarre. I believe the answer lies at least in part in the early congressional hearings on climate change. The first of these was in 1977 before the Senate Subcommittee on Science, Technology and Space, note that, Science, Technology and Space, and that was in support of establishing the National Climate Program Act that I mentioned earlier, which established a funding stream for scientific research. And at this time, climatology was a tiny, rather obscure field. Another key hearing, the next one really, was carbon dioxide and the greenhouse effect. And that was before the House, again, Science and Technology Committee in 1981. The issue was still considered something of a niche topic. But in 1988, a scorching heat wave hit the USA, shifting the emphasis from a purely research focus to an overtly political one. The venue also shifted from the science committees in Congress to the Senate Energy and Natural Resources Committee. And over the course of these hearings, scientists called to give evidence moved from offering diagnosis to also offering prescriptions. The political implication of which was, if you don't like my prescription, you have to contest my diagnosis, or at least that's your best bet to avoid taking the pill that I'm telling you you're going to have to take. And of course, that prescription consisted of three pills that would be bitter ones for conservatives to swallow. Firstly, intervening in energy markets. Secondly, international or world governance. And thirdly, redistribution of wealth, particularly to the developing world. By the way, you don't need to read German to understand the body language of this cartoon, which has been produced more recently by a German government agency, but unwittingly it shows exactly what American conservatives dread, foreign scientists lecturing the President of the United States, holding his head down shamefully, taking his instructions about what needs to be done in order to save the planet. Thank you very much. Thus were the conditions for the climate science wars unwittingly laid down by the climate scientists themselves. Had those scientists confined themselves to identifying the problem and telling the politicians, we've warned you about this big problem coming down the pipe, what are you guys going to do about it? And then taking themselves off back to the university or the ivory tower, then it's possible we might have been having a different kind of argument about policy responses for the past 20 years instead of this pointless surrogate argument about the credibility of climate science. Of course, we can't run the counterfactual, so we will never know. But what we can say is that the scientists created a hostage to fortune and a commitment to a predict and provide approach to climate change, which depends heavily on the ability of science to make accurate and unambiguous predictions, rather than having an approach of building societal resilience to climatic variability. So where are we today? Survey research by my colleague, Yale University's Dan Kahan, shows a direct linear correlation between political orientation and expressions of concern about climate risk. Correlation is not causation, of course, but it seems unlikely that people decided to become Republicans or Democrats on the basis of their assessments of the seriousness of the scientific message about climate change. It seems much more plausible they've made up their minds about climate science as a result of their identification with conservative or liberal politics. Furthermore, if we opt for the less likely hypothesis, we're still left with the problem of explaining how the skeptical conservatives came to reject the messages of climate science in the first place. Now, there are those, who, and we've heard some of this in this morning's presentation, who argue that climate skeptics are simply misled by large corporate interests, such as ExxonMobil, who've been promulgating misinformation. And while it's undoubtedly true that certain industrial interests have acted in this way, it cannot explain why Republicans are more susceptible to such messages than are Democrats. It certainly cannot be that Republicans are simply stupider or less scientifically literate than Democrats. And I'm still saying that with a straight face even after yesterday's news. But actually, if we dig into it, I'm afraid it's true. It would be a serious mistake to equate low concern among conservatives with lack of scientific sophistication or with some kind of cognitive deficit. Again, as Dan Kahan has shown here, scientific literacy, indicated by standard measures, only serves to exacerbate scientific disagreement because both sides feel able to draw on scientific arguments to justify their positions. And this is actually consistent with other social science findings on the effect of scientific literacy on environmental controversies. By the way, I should point out here for those of you who are wondering, just remind you that in the US, the colors of the political parties are reversed. So the blue line is the Democrats and the red line there, and the red line there represents Republicans. So we're left with the idea that claims of climate skepticism may have more to do with identity than with the cognitive states of the claimants. When conservatives hear the question, do you believe in climate change? The question they seem to hear is, what kind of a person are you? The answer, I'm a climate skeptic, is actually a coded way of announcing, I'm a conservative who's committed to small government and especially keeping government from messing with markets. Now this matters because, as we've already seen, the mainstream scientific response and the response from the political left has been to emphasize the maturity of the science and the strength of the scientific consensus behind it. There have been numerous social media campaigns stressing the so-called 97% of scientists agree, the clear implication being that somebody could only be an idiot if they distrusted such a strong consensus. But the deeper problem with asking conservative skeptics to trust this consensus is that only 6% of scientists polled by the Pew Center in 2009 identified themselves to be Republicans, while 55% identified themselves as Democrats. And if Republicans are suspicious of the motives of climate scientists who they see as advocating policies that fly in the face of their cherished values of the free market, the sovereignty and independence of the US from foreigners, and the American dream of individual self-betterment by one's own efforts, why on earth should they be expected to trust Democrats, who they see as identifying with government interventionism, global government, and global welfare? The insistence that climate skeptics accept the science has at times, particularly in the US, taken on the tone of Reformation and Counter-Reformation theological debates, in which each side insisted that the other must recant their beliefs and confess their error as a prior condition of any kind of reconciliation and common cause. Republican paranoia about big government is matched only by the eagerness with which Democrats and scientists embrace a Manichaean view in which the righteous and downtrodden are victimized by a conspiracy of big business spreading disinformation. And as I say, while there is clear evidence that some, such as Exxon, have deliberately muddied the waters, as we've seen in the works of Orestes and Conway, this view fails to ask why such distortions fall on such fertile ground, and why are the extensive efforts to present the counter-arguments failing to persuade those who are inclined to skepticism? The credibility of climate science reflects the same deep identity issues as Brexit and Tuesday's presidential election. And it's a pity. It's a pity because both sides have lost sight of the great tradition of American pragmatism. As one of its principal exponents, the commentator Walter Lippmann, famously argued, democracy is not about getting people who think differently to think the same thing, it's getting people who think differently to do the same thing. Now, John mentioned this morning that he didn't think any of us would have read the paper encyclical, although I'm actually Jewish, not Catholic. I have read the paper encyclical. And I was delighted to see Pope Francis embrace a position not entirely dissimilar from the earlier 20th century American pragmatist, and advocating a pluralistic approach, explicitly recognizing, quote, there is no one path to a solution to climate change, and, quote, solutions will not emerge from just one way of interpreting and transforming reality. And there is scope to get people who think differently to do the same thing. According to a 2013 study, nearly 60% of farmers in Mississippi and Texas, both bastions of climate skepticism, believe there will be some change in crop mix resulting from climate change. In fact, there's much less divergence than one might expect in the behavior of believers and disbelievers. If you look in the agricultural sector in the United States, because they are already experiencing and perceiving changes under which they are having to conduct agricultural activity. There's ample evidence, in fact, that farmers across the US who claim not to believe in climate change science nevertheless are adopting practices such as no-till planting, new patterns of crop rotation, adjustment to changing projections of growing seasons, and so on, in response to what they call the new normal. The same farmers who praised members of Congress for voting down National Science Foundation funding of climate research were up in arms against the members of Congress, the same politicians voting to cut USDA research that would help them adapt to a changing climate regime. It would seem that these same people who are, when they are in their communities on the weekend, claim to be climate change skeptics, when they climb on their tractors during the week, suddenly become climate change believers. And what's wrong with that? I would actually argue that cognitive dissonance of this sort is actually the normal human condition. Speaking personally, I am committed both to a Benthamite utilitarian idea of the greatest happiness of the greatest number, at the same time as I'm equally committed to a Kantian notion that there are imprescriptible rights that should not be violated. And it's the human condition that we, in our daily lives, have to negotiate our commitment to very contradictory ideas. And that, I would argue, is what we're facing with these kinds of climate skeptics in the US agricultural sector. And I'm encouraged by this, because it seems to me that this is the basis upon which we, if we focus on actions rather than on beliefs, we can actually make progress with building a response to climate change that would be much more resilient and effective. And it also reflects my experience of talking privately with Republican skeptics, again over a beer, who will confide, there's probably something to all this climate change stuff, but I'll be damned if I'll allow the Democrats to use it to pursue their big government agenda. So, in a nutshell, here are my conclusions. Beyond the basic physics, science is actually much less settled than implied by the 97% of scientists agree claim. However, it is at least as good as the information used for policy and business decisions, and on that basis, its imperfections should be no obstacle to going forward with sensible climate policies. However, again, the policy debates about what is sensible is hampered by the perpetuation of inappropriate expertise, this kind of linear model that we have to understand the climate science more and more fully before we can move to making sensible policies. I would argue that the origins of climate skepticism lie in the claims made by scientists in early congressional hearings, where they set themselves up by offering not just a prescription, not just a diagnosis, but a prescription. And I think there's an important lesson to be taken there. I would argue further that I've argued further that climate skepticism is not about cognitive states, but about assertions of identity. Climate debates are therefore not about the competence of the expert or experts, and indeed that attempts at expert persuasion are wrong-headed and frequently counterproductive. The way to effective climate action is to meet people where they are, not changing their hearts and minds. Thank you.